So again, welcome everybody. We're going to discuss the fundamentals of ecosystem strategies. Today we are here to present also an event, masterclass, that we will be hosting together with Estade Creapolis in Barcelona in June 6 and 7. Together with me, that's a lot of people, of course, but we have Lucia from our team based in Barcelona, and Victor from Estade Creapolis. Both of you, if you want to just say hello and just introduce yourself very quickly. Starting by Lucia, so we don't make confusion.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to this webinar. I'm Lucia, I'm part of the team of Boundaryless. I'm a kind of platform economy expert, working on that for 6 years now. And I'm happy to be here.
Hello, everybody. This is Victor from the team of Estade Creapolis. As I'm going to explain right now, we work in different areas, all of them related to innovation and ecosystems. So we are very glad to be here with you.
Super. Well, thank you both. So again, there will be a Q&A session at the end of the first part of the webinar. So we will be back in the discussion with Lucia and Victor and the others in a few minutes. So what are we, actually, maybe Victor, you could use this as a background for your introduction. I don't know if you want to add a couple of words on the Estade Creapolis ecosystem.
Yes, a very short introduction, Simone. Thank you. Thank you so much. Maybe you don't know about the Estade Creapolis. We are a business and knowledge park. And above all, we are at the service of Estade Business School to become the link with the innovation system and the business world. So what we do is to help companies to innovate by providing dynamic ecosystems to inspire, facilitate that, and accelerate the innovations. And this ecosystem is based with our link and our connection with the Estade Business School. So we give corporates, large corporations and SMEs the opportunity to have access to talent, teachers and alumni. So we work in different areas, for instance, entrepreneurship or retail, urban mobility, sustainability, and of course, ecosystems. And for this reason, we are very glad to be here in this webinar and to co-host the masterclass that will take place here at the Estade Creapolis the first week of June.
Thank you again. Sorry for the quick interruption. So again, if you guys can mute your mic, that would be great. So we start to dive into the webinar content. So first of all, let me share a couple of words on what we do and who we are. I'm the originator of this project in 2013, the Platform Design Toolkit project. It started, as a fork of the Business Model Canvas. And we have been working on this methodology now for 5 years. There's a company called Boundaryless that is evolving the methodology, but also extending it. And I would say also extending the overall thinking behind platforms and ecosystems, much beyond a methodology, I would say. But just to give you a quick set of numbers, we have more than 20,000 adopters all over the world. Of the free and open source methodology. We have been training more than 400 people in Europe and the US in the last few years in public events. And private events have been involving more than 50 customers and projects worldwide. And our customer base, I would say our partner base or adopter base, ranges from big institutions like the United Nations to small startups or NGOs or social enterprises or even designers. So that methodology so far is, I would say, based on a user guide that is completely open source. Now it's being complemented by other things that we are going to talk about later. There's a set of essential canvases that you can use to prototype your designs, and more other advanced ones. I would say some advanced aspects of our methodology that are still a subject of research. We have been also complementing the method with patterns and principles. So we are now working on other tools that we will use to complement, I would say, the design practice. Everything is always updated on our blog. So it's really important for you, if you are interested in the developments of the research, to stay on top of the news by looking up our Medium stories of platform design blog. As Victor said and Lucia said, we are going to have this masterclass in Barcelona after, you know, many, many European cities. We are just back from Eindhoven and previously New York in March. So it's really, it's going to be the last one before the summer. And then we're going to announce some more dates coming up after the summer. So the topics of the session are going to be essentially three. First, I'm going to dive into the basics of platforms and ecosystems thinking. Then I'm going to talk about the coming age of platforms. So I would say what's up in the future of platform thinking. And then giving you more context. And then we are going to spend a couple of a few minutes, basically explaining how to use the toolkit, possibly how to work with us. More practically, I would say. Again, if you guys want to share any question, please share it in the global chat, and then we will take care of assessing them at the end of the webinar. So first of all, the basic mechanics of platforms and ecosystem. Of course, everybody's talking about platforms. We know that we are essentially talking about a transition between an industrial age and a platform age, or somehow it's I would say a transition towards what we call the post-industrial age. All this topic has been discussed widely by tons of books. Some are better than others. Many have different points of view on the topic. One book that we normally really suggest is this book from Barry Liebert and others, because it's a quantitative analysis, I would say, of how businesses are changing and what are the key characteristics of what Barry calls network orchestrators. So essentially, these companies that more or less create value by connecting. And I think it's really interesting to look at this incipit of the book. It's really direct and, it basically explains that for existing organization, the question is really either understanding how this mode of production, I would say, works, or really getting crazy challenges to really stay afloat in changing and complex world. Essentially, we are used to this to business models, industrial business models. Of asset builders, service providers, and technology creators, more or less, of course. Nothing is black and white, but these are the most recurring industrial business models. And as I said, the question is now, how do we embrace a new kind of thinking, a new kind of business model or organizational model that is that of a network orchestrators that essentially creates value, deliver value through generating connections? So, Some examples may be just to help us wrap our heads around this idea. Everybody knows Airbnb is probably the most discussed platform all over the world and one of the most successful, for sure. It's connecting essentially everybody that is dealing with tourism around our cities. And essentially connects guests, hosts, but increasingly a set of more complex stakeholders, especially experienced hosts, if you're familiar with the topic, but now increasingly also hotels, for example, from the acquisition of Hotels Tonight, but in general, a full set of professionals that are active, I would say, around the business of travel. Another good example that we normally do is Salesforce AppExchange. It's really interesting because at the end of the day, it connects consultants, service providers, essentially developers and adopters of the AppExchange, of the Salesforce stack. And it's really interesting because it's 12 years old, and it has been really instrumental in putting Salesforce at the forefront of the industry. So essentially in creating a success path for Salesforce, thanks to the leverage of the ecosystem that was involved in this evolution. This idea of becoming more successful and resilient based on involving an ecosystem in your evolution and transformation is something that a company like Shopify is embodying very thoroughly. I think it's really interesting to look at the numbers of Shopify. This company is creating an ecosystem strategy, a platform strategy around e-commerce, and is connecting not just sellers and buyers, or maybe sellers and developers, for example, to develop their own websites, but it's also connecting the sellers, the entrepreneur, with a large set of players that can really help providing all sorts of professional support, for example, on branding or communication or merchandising and so on. So basically, it's a place where you can also get in touch with the experts and not just with the technology. And it's really interesting because if you look at the numbers of Spotify, these are for 2017, but the numbers are more or less growing steadily. Shopify enables more money, more value than the value they captures. So it's really a good hint in starting to think about how do we measure success of ecosystem strategies, ecosystems organizations. So in this case, it's clear that the success of this company is dictated by the success of its ecosystem. So it's really important to look at things differently and to learn that the new KPIs of ecosystems organizations are going to be different from the APIs of the industrial ones. Another good example that we normally do is that of Current. It's a company from General Electric. I think, if I'm not wrong, is now being sold to another company. But it's really interesting because it's related to an existing industrial context, that of lightnings, I would say. Indeed, it's some kind of spin-off or evolution of current of GE Lightning. And so basically, this company works on a technology layer that basically consists in embedding sensors and actuators in all the products like lights or something like that. And basically, this technology is connected to a data analytics layer powered by Predix, that is the data analytics, I would say, engine of General Electric. And it's interesting, basically connects technology providers, independent software vendors and developers with industrial players like cities, like retailers or big factory owners. And basically all partners provide some vertical capability I would say, develop or deploy some intelligent applications on top of some kind of standardized infrastructure of sensors and data. And it's really, really interesting. As I said, for example, in a moment in which General Electric has been going through not really good waters, I would say, GE Current was one of the successful, endeavors. And that's it. And also, it's really interesting to see how an existing incumbent has been looking into this kind of platform ecosystem model to innovate radically one of its lines of business. So at the end of the day, if we look at really the essentials of platform thinking, we are thinking about essentially three things. So we are thinking about, for sure, some tools and processes and technologies the things that normally one would relate more often to a platform strategy. Also, everybody's talking about websites when you talk about platforms, but in reality, the tools, the processes, and the technologies, I would say they are just one of the aspects. So for sure, these technologies and tools, they support players in a wider system. And these players essentially share a context, no? Essentially share a place where they can play at their best. Of course, to attract them, to motivate them to join this context, it's often not enough to just pitch a set of tools and processes and technologies. You also need to give them some kind of shaping narrative. Also, what John Hagel normally calls a narrative of extended opportunities. So it's a mix of, I would say, a platform strategy, at least it's a mix of a story, a motivating story that basically tells everybody playing a context that they can be more successful if they join this shared place, and a set of tools, processes, and technologies. So I make an example, and I think it's really powerful. You know, imagine that you basically find people playing football in the street, and you told them, if you join us, we're going to provide you a championship, I would say, and also a professional pitch, the referee, a rule book, we are going to control the everything as well, give you the ball, and so on. So the question is really about creating a place where the participants can play at their best. They can excel. Sometimes we say that platform strategies are about not about telling how good you are as an organizer, but how good the participants could be if they join your new strategy. So all this is happening before, for sure, you know, because of a couple of aspects. For sure, on one hand, we have enablers. So we have an increasing potential that is growing at the edge of the system. So what I mean with potential, I mean, you know, basically now, thanks to the pervasive technologies, you can create all sorts of value by using a computer or phone. You can leverage on cloud technologies and you know, machine learning and big data. All these cloud services and centralized services. Now with the blockchain, you can even use decentralized infrastructures. There is increasingly, you know, a huge amount of knowledge. Here you can see Wikipedia logo, but the question is even if you think about, for example, open source software, it's even more. You know, you can even leverage on software and processes in the open. And increasingly, these pervasive, powerful technologies are also entering new industries. Even with 3D printers or computer-controlled machines, it's even now a matter of manufacturing. So one key aspect of the platform transformation is for sure that potential is growing fast and stronger at the edge of the system. So the small is becoming more powerful. On the other hand, drivers, there's a strong driver for basically personalization and a special taste. So everybody wants something special. We know that from the age of the long tail, we know that now is the age of personalization, the age of customization. So the question is, what happens when potential and expectations grow at the edge of the system? It's for sure much more powerful and much more performing to essentially adapt a network shape instead of a pipeline shape. It's very easy to understand. You know, it's much more about connecting them than controlling production in one place and mass and trying to convince everybody that they need to consume the same thing. So, you know, what's the key reason to embrace this paradigm in this kind of shifting context? We use this metaphor sometimes because it's really, I think it's really good. The question is, if you try to address an ultra personalized and a super contextualized and complex market with industrial solutions, with this tank, you're going to essentially move a big bureaucratic machine trying to produce value for one single customer, a specific value from one single customer, for example, and this is going to be not sustainable from an economic perspective. So what happens normally is that if companies trying to respond to the dynamic complexity and personalization of the post-industrial markets with an industrial approach, they fail. They fail badly, they have huge cost structures, and this doesn't really work. So they don't want to see these expectations. You know, they don't want to deal with special customers. They don't want to deal with this kind of ultra mass personalization. A good example of this pattern, I think, is Apple. You know, if you think about how many developers are active on Apple marketplace, it's crazy. You know, there are more than 250,000 developers on the Apple ecosystem, and there's no way that Apple could have hired them. You know, basically, Apple says less than 100,000 employees, and there are more than 250,000 developers. Imagine if Apple could have hired them and told them what to do, what applications to develop, and how to and help them, you know, marketize them. No, so this is really, really something impossible. Somehow, the iPhone is one of the first post-industrial products that we have been seeing, you know, winning on the market. So the question is, how do we move from providing mass personalization from the center to enabling contextual self-organization? So enabling, for example, producers and consumers, like in this case, developers and users, to self-organize and decide what applications do they need. So this is what platforms are all about. If we look more broadly, I would say, and we try to contextualize a bit more the topic, I would say, not just thinking about one platform, what we see in reality is what we could call the platform age. So, of course, we have this long tail. We have these producers and consumers interacting in markets, which are increasingly more personalized and small to small. So basically bigger markets, but made of smaller interactive players. Of course, all this is powered by what we call aggregators. This is normally what we call the platform. So the business that connects, essentially, you know, creates value from interaction and creates both the channels to interact and empowers, let's say, the interactive entities to share value. And on top of all this is built on top of large infrastructures. You know, one of the most famous is, for example, Amazon Web Services, or, you know, all the other, you know, the Google services and so on. So basically all these infrastructures provide you the enabling building blocks to build aggregation strategies, so to build platforms somehow. You know, that's more or less what I said. So of course, the two layers below, so the network orchestrators, the aggregators and the infrastructures, are more subject to a concentration dynamic because of the nature of the economies of scale for the infrastructures and because of the nature of the network effects for the aggregators. So what do I mean with network effects? If we just look at the aggregators that connect, indeed, you know, the network effects are driven by a specific, you know, way that aggregators have to accrue value. And essentially, when you have an aggregator, so essentially you have a market, you have producers and consumers, you have members of a network that interact, the value that you perceive as a new player in this championship, let's say, is driven up by the number of players. So imagine that you are, yeah, I mean, I think you can imagine market, you know, any kind of physical market is more valuable for as much as you can find many seller in the marketplace, you know. Otherwise, you don't go there if you just have one seller. So the very idea of markets is really related, and networks is really related to growing value with a growing number of players interacting. Very quickly, let's try to look at what does it mean in terms of value chain, because that's also a very important lens that helps us to understand how these kind of strategies are transforming markets. So when you look at the, you know, I'm not going to explain the details. That if you guys are interested, there is a web blog post that we will also attach to the post webinar email, where essentially you can understand better what I'm explaining now. But here you can see there is a description of a value chain of an industrial service. It's described by means of the Simon Wardley value chain maps, Wardley maps. So basically here you can find elements of a value chain and they are plotted against, you know, an evolutionary line here. Here on the left you have the things that have been just invented essentially. Here on the right you have the things that have been evolving towards becoming a common utility, let's say, within time. And as you can see, basically a typical industrial service provider tries to control purchasing, customer warranty, and business process as something that is very specific. And they basically, this is what they normally produce. Then they leverage on suppliers and utilities and components, and they try to provide the user with a common and, you know, one size fits all value proposition. What happens with the platform strategies is that normally they transform value chains in this way, in this graphical way, but more practically what happens is that they create deeply contextual interactions. So as you can see here, they bring basically the suppliers back on top of the value chain and they started to consider them as interactive entities, that they don't hide them anymore into the supply chain, let's say. No, they try to consider them as users. In this process, they standardize the transaction flow. So basically, they create a standardized transaction on top of which you can customize your interactions between producers and consumers, but using a standardized, I would say, system of transactions. So imagine Airbnb. All interactions with Airbnb, between guests and hosts is really, really special. You know, it's typical, but at the same time, it happens on a very much a standardized engine of interaction. So you book everything in the same way, you pay everything in the same way, you do the reputation review in the same way, but it's always something special, you know, because it somehow allows you to be disobedient enough to find your own way to use it. The other key aspects of value chain transformation are related to, basically standardizing a business process into a cheap software as a service and introducing reputation, identity, and trust. So often when you use a service from non-industrial players, so from a platform, you need to trust the other person. So basically you need to trust the other individual or the other small organization. As I said, you know, you move from interacting with a brand centralized in a centralized way into interacting with another party facilitated by a brand. So of course you will need to trust this new party, you know, that you are not normally used to trust. Imagine the first person that jumped into a Uber, that was not a taxi driver, you know, or someone that for the first time jumps into BlaBlaCar. And it's really interesting, BlaBlaCar case, again, this is something we can share with you, has been very interesting to watch how the company built this kind of reputation and trust engine, not because you really need to deal with this trust issue in the platform economy. So in terms of market, of value proposition, and again, I'm not going to be in the details here because there is this blog post you can watch, you can read. Here, you know, it's how the value chain is reshaped by platforms. As you can see, there are producers and consumers on top of the value chain. So they are both, considered as users. And normally the platform strategy controls the transaction, the software as a service, the reputation, and the identity. So these are normally the elements that are controlled by a platform player. So few key elements before we move into the final part of the presentation on the context. I would say every platform has two very important engines. So you know, when you become a network shaper, a platform shaper, when you want to organize an ecosystem, you need to provide a transaction engine. So essentially you need to build the channels. And on the other side, you need to create engines of continuous learning. So on one side is about reducing the transaction costs for them to interact. On the other side is about to support them to learn new things and develop new capabilities. Because basically, if we accept that platforms are emerging as an answer to increasing complexity in markets and society, we will need to understand that the mission of our company, of our organization, is going to be about evolution. It's going to be about helping entities in the ecosystem to learn new things, hone new capabilities, discover new opportunities, and essentially at the end of the day, it's about facing increasing complexity. So you can imagine, for example, a metaphor of a platform as a city. And on one hand, it's of course you need to build the roads, let's say. No. On the other hand, you will need to also build the core services, no, like the I don't know, the healthcare or police and something like that. You know. So basically, that's the idea. So this is also another quick recap on the difference between the industrial organization and the platform organization. This is more or less what we just said. And you know, you move from the customer perspective into the ecosystem age. So it's no more about a single consumer to which you're going to sell a solution. It's going to be about how do you help the context to find solutions. How do you help the conversations and the interactions to happen on top of a standardized infrastructure of interaction that you're going to create? So that's more or less the difference between the two approaches. And it's quite epochal difference, I would say. So very quickly, let's move into the context. So, you know, this is more or less the dynamics and the mechanics of platforms. But, you know, at the end of the day, what does it mean now for us? You know, because everybody, you know, of course, you're not going to make another Airbnb. You're not going to make another Uber. So the question is, how can we leverage this in the future? How can we as brands or people or organizations leverage this paradigm to transform society and to create successful organizations? So I like to refer to Ben Evans, The End of the Beginning, that's a presentation that was shared in December last year. And basically, together with another very interesting work from Andrew Chen, the two, you know, ironically enough, both of them are Anderson Horowitz fellows, basically highlighted that there is a huge market opportunity. Evans says that more or less 8 trillion just in the US are about part of the consumer spending that is not organized by platforms yet. And Andrew Chen was really, this blog post was really good to explain what is next in terms of the impacts of marketplaces and platforms on reorganizing service economy. And at the end of the day, we can say that in the next 20 years, there is more or less globally $25 trillion of economy to reorganize in these terms. And it's going to be about businesses that have high trust, high impact, they are strongly contextual, they are complex business processes. So it's not going to be about, simple things like transportation or travel, no? So it's going to be about personal services and much more. For example, we are already seeing things like Wonder School, that is a marketplace for education, or things such as Freightos, that is a marketplace for freights. So it's really, you know, basically the message that I feel we can give is that there is no industry safe. So everything is going to be platformized because it's much more efficient as a paradigm. We will see in a moment also in which ways. And there's no more such thing as an industry. So basically the other point here is your company, your context is no more your core business. So you can look much broader. You can look much farther than what you're actually doing now. And I like to quote Rita McGrath when she said that basically now we compete in arenas, no more in industries. So it's much more about what the ecosystem tells you. So, you know, basically innovation is coming from outside of your organization. The question is, how do you capture it? How do you play a role to facilitate this emergence of innovations radically and continuously in society? And, you know, it's the arena that dictates the value. It's not your company, basically, or your organization. So quite quickly, also, I want to mention that there are two major technologies that are coming. For example, Benedict Evans, you know, basically describes them as potentially market resets technologies. One is machine learning and one is crypto. For sure, yeah, that's it. For sure, machine learning is about essentially creating economies that are less dependent on human labor, augment the capability of creators, help us to create more meaning from more data, and help us to do better matchmaking and context awareness in platforms, so understand better how an interaction is happening, what kind of interactions should we facilitate, and so on. But the impact of crypto, I think, is even more profound, and we will see in a moment. But basically, crypto is enabling many other things. So first of all, is enabling the possibility to have sovereign identities. So basically, people that control their own data, their own reputation, their own social capital. It's going to ensure more and more platform-to-platform interoperability. And the question is, you know, the pressing need for platform-to-platform interoperability, so to help people and individuals and organizations to freely interact in different platforms, something that is now not really happening, is going to be so strong that there will be a push to have this platform-to-platform interoperability, and crypto may constitute technology to develop this kind of interoperability. And also, it's going to be easier to embed financial and governance rights in tradable assets. So basically, in helping ecosystems, not just to create, produce, and consume value, but also to invest together in future value. Mm-hmm. So what's coming up, as Axeli puts it from EXA, is that basically crypto is opening up economy itself as a design space. So, you know, we have been used to platforms where we design for convenience and letting people consume what they want to consume and produce what they want to produce. Soon we will deal with platform strategies that will enable entire ecosystems to see the future and to bet on the future and to invest on the future. So basically you are going to have not just producers and consumers, but I would say this idea of an entrepreneur. So collaborative entrepreneur that will design, will invest, will be involved in governance and decision making. So, you know, basically crypto and other technologies for sure are ramping up a lot our possibilities to shape the future collectively as systems, I would say. And this is, as you can imagine, this is quite challenging to the very idea of organization. Basically today I'm publishing a blog post I will also share with you, where we try to put together some of these ideas. But in general, I would say that we need to end this this webinar for the last few minutes talking about, I would say, reality to a broader extent. So looking at a broader context in which we are going to play with these tools, we are going to play with these strategies, we are going to play with these approaches. And if we look broader, essentially, you know, if we look at the next 20 years, we are going to deal with a lot of challenges. We are going to deal with an increasing complexity in the world. This is an extract of World Economic Forum Risk Index. And I'm using this because it's important to understand that when we let's say, when we start to understand how we invest collectively in the future in a local way, for example, or in a distributed way, or an interconnected way, we are going to take all our risks as communities, as you know, basically production economies, or as productive ecosystems, when we are able all together to collaborate, invest, and govern, for sure we are going to address our systemic liabilities. We are going to address our problems. We are never going to be designing just for convenience. This gives you a quick idea of what kind of challenges we face. Some of them, most of them, I would say, are related to the pressing climate and environmental instabilities. So most likely, you know, we need to become more familiar, for example, with things such as the need to reduce our carbon footprint. According to the IPCC, we need to mitigate our carbon emissions of the 18% a year. Now, basically, this is going to be very challenging. It's going to be impactful to many of the things that we get for granted nowadays. So, for example, lots of products and business models that now embed a lot of carbon, they will increasingly be seen as a liability for companies, as a problem, not as an advantage. You know probably that a company as big as IKEA now is explaining that it wants to transition to zero carbon very soon and is considering even stopping selling furniture but renting furniture. So this is the kind of context that we're going to live in the next 20 years. We need to reinvent a lot of business models. We need to reinvent a lot of organizational models to reduce our carbon footprint, but in general to reduce our resource intensive business models. This week we had this a week long of demonstrations in London with climate activists claiming and basically getting to speak with decision makers. It's really, really mounting. You know, there's a shift happening now, thankfully. So the next 20 years are going to be really, really interesting in terms of how do we reinvent the economy. And also I wanted to point you to this open letter on climate-related risks that most of the central banks in Europe have been releasing last week. This is to say that even the investors, the institutional investors like banks or I don't know, issuers or funds, they will need to invest in future business models. So there will be a lot of money that needs to go away from fossil fuels and it needs to go into the future of platforms and essentially regenerative platforms, platforms that are going to take all systemic risks. So that could be even a relevant opportunity for organizations and individuals that want to create these kind of new platforms. So essentially what we can expect in the next 20 years is that there are huge liabilities coming up for fossil fuel intensive business models. We are going to see probably a reduction of the shipping and global commerce that may halt these kind of business models and pointing to a rising glocalism, no? So basically new regenerative and glocal economies and these kind of platforms that are going to substitute, global trade or carbon-intensive business models and generate a much better resilience. So let me make a very stupid example. In towns, we are going to see much less private cars and much more shared mobility, for example. We are going to see a lot of possibilities in energy production and many, many other things I'm going to talk about in a second. One lens we can use to look at this new potential is the donut economics from Kate Raworth. It's really interesting. So the idea is to how do we create wealth and well-being by organizing the economy, taking into account the Earth boundaries. So how do we create this economy that is safe and just? How do we create this economy that has a social foundation and an ecological ceiling? So it's really, really work that you need to dive into. It's really interesting. And yeah, that's it. I mean, probably what we are going to see, as I said before, we are going to see a lot of an explosion of new models in food production, energy, personal service, in welfare, in care, in education. You know, for example, very interesting to see how in the US now there's an exponential departure from institutional and industrial educational models. So it's really, everything is going to be reinvented. We have massive opportunities. Lots of money is going to go away from industrial fossil fuel intensive models into rebuilding the future. And this is going to be what we are going to talk about. If you are interested more in details, you can look into a blog post that we released in January that explains how, you know, the platform economy is a huge thing, and our attention needs to go into the spaces, the platforms that are more relationship driven, more enabling, more focused on the mastery and empathy and relationship building, and more, I would say, contextual. So, again, that's a broad post, but you can also dive deep into it. We will put you this link in the post webinar information. Let me go a bit faster. To do this, I think we really need to familiarize with the idea of scaling across. So it's not more about scaling up. You know, scale has been and growth has been our obsession when we talk about platforms. And it's really, now we need to understand how do we scale and generate network effects in a new way. So basically connecting nodes of broader networks that may, you know, generate solutions that work at a more local scale. So, you know, that's going to be another adventure to discover how to generate scale in a decentralized and distributed way. And also how our organizations can deal with these new possibilities. This is going to be very, very, very interesting and important. Let me close this webinar 2 minutes with, because I'm already 45 minutes into the explanation. How can you use Platform Design Toolkit and what the Platform Design Toolkit is all about? So, you know, basically we have these 4 phases normally. You know, that's, of course, that's a simplification, but we need to start from somewhere. So you normally have 4 stages in envisioning a platform strategy and ecosystem mobilization strategy. A first one is about exploring and understanding. Then it's about designing your strategy. Then it's a cycle between designing the strategy and prototyping it. And then it's about growing. So generating network effects. It deals with launching, solving your chicken egg problems, and so on. So exploring opportunities for this specific potential, for this specific phase, we have created a dedicated guide. So basically there's a process we have been testing and it's very advanced. We are evolving it, but you can also leverage on our platform opportunity exploration guide that is available on our website and is again in Creative Commons released and open source and helps you to do essentially 2 things. First of all, to map what is existing in the ecosystem, what kind of behaviors are existing, and then plot them into the value chain and understand how you can basically use those you know, recurring strategic plays that we spoke about, like, you know, standardization of transactions and things like that, to reshape the value chain in a new way. So this is a very much a strategic, high-level, and informative process that we really advise, you know, because it's going to make you much more aware of the industry or the context you're going to shape. And then, of course, the core of our methodology is about design and validation. So there are currently 7 canvases in the basic platform design toolkit. There's a strong user guide that has everything explained. You really need to just download it and test it out with your teams. We have been in touch with thousands of people that have been doing this. And soon we are also going to release an online board, thanks to a collaboration we are having with Miro, that is a software company doing real-time collaboration boards. It's going to be very, very interesting. But so far, I mean, you can download, you can print the canvases, and you can just play with that. Or, of course, you can learn how to use it. You can do that by joining our masterclasses. As I said, there's one coming up in Barcelona on June 6th and 7th. We are probably going to launch very soon also online masterclasses. I would say even in this effort to reduce our own carbon footprint and to make it easier for people to use our services without polluting the environment. But so far, I would say we have these live masterclasses. The one is coming in Barcelona on 6th and 7th of June. And of course, you can also work with us. And basically, normally when we work with companies, we work on essentially many things, but recurrently on business strategy innovation. So essentially, how do we create a new business? How do we explore new opportunities based on our identity or our assets or the markets or the context that we want to address? And of course, also, how do we, I would say, evolve our organization? Because as you can see, as you can imagine, it takes a lot to create an organization that is really platform and ecosystem focused and capable of creating these strategies. No, because we, you know, as Mel Conway said at the end of the 60s, you know, you cannot basically create anything different than what you are. So you really need to transform your identity as an organization if you want to be a protagonist of the age of platforms. In our private engagements normally are either training events or innovation design structure processes, like design sprints and things like that. And we also do long-term research and development with brands that are really, really focused on understanding the future. You know, because as you can see, there's a lot of challenges coming up. Our organization really need to look into the future without any concern and see what kind of role they can play. Coming up in the 2020 and 2019, we also have idea to launch, well, we're actually actively working to launch a council for organizations that have adopted our methodology, a conference, which is now targeting the first quarter of 2020. And probably soon we're going to start a podcast. So you can be involved in all of these things as a sponsor or partner. So if your organization is interested in exploring the future, really get in touch, because there are massive opportunities to do some great work and to inspire a lot of employees, adopters, users, and other companies. Those are some of our very interesting customers in the past. We've been working with all kinds of organizations, really trying to help them to understand the future and complexity. And some of them have been more successful. Some others have been just playing with the topic. But, you know, this is just some of them. The big ones, but as I said, you know, there are thousands of adopters of our methodology that even don't even get in touch with us, you know, and make the best alone. So, a quick conclusion, and then I will leave it to you for the questions for half an hour maximum questions. You know, understanding platforms and ecosystem is crucial. It's going to be crucial in the future. For institutions, platforms, organizations. Our current understanding, I would say, of platforms is still very much rooted in an industrial age that is in transition. So there are challenges due to the fact that the contextual framing will probably change fast due to instabilities, you know, climate instabilities, for example, or even social tensions on mode of production that are, you know, too much, extracting too much resources, or, you know, everybody knows, for example, all the questions that arise around the impact that Airbnb has on cities, for example, or the impacts that Uber has having on the taxi industries. So the question is, new technologies, innovations create tensions, we need to address them. Then post-industrial platforms might look really, really different. So might be doing different things, like, you know, higher context, more complex processes, more important things like food, energy, education, whatever, more resilience, more global strategies, more scaling across than scaling up. And there's a potential, huge potential in developing new collective governance and ownership models generating new different expectations, new risks and liabilities going to be solved. That's going to be a very interesting ride in the next 20 years. We are here to explore together with you. And one thing I want to end up with a note, it's really, really important that we understand that no individual organization can solve the future. It's going to be about massive collaborations. That's why you really need to understand what does it mean to motivate ecosystems, to motivate parties to join, share plans, share targets, shared liabilities, shared innovation. So that's more or less what awaits us in the next decades. Let's give up to the challenge. That's it. I think it was very long. I'm sorry about that. I hope it was at least interesting. It took something like 50 minutes. Let me get back to you and see your faces. I see there are a couple of questions in the chat. That's it. Let's see if I can see them. Okay, so questions are related to the recording. So at that point in time, what I would do is leave it to you. To each any of you that wants to raise some questions.
Remember, if you want to speak, you should unmute yourself. Yeah,
that's what I was saying.
It's bottom left button.
Okay, let me just look into this. Okay, I don't see any question coming, possibly. Any reflections that you guys want to share? Again, it's not really about questions. It's also about what you feel like sharing with the others here in the other 30 people in the room.
Hi, Simone.
Hello, Edward, right?
Yeah, Edward from India.
Edward.
I've been new to this platform design, so apologies. My question would be very primitive, but still I'm curious to understand and learn. My question is a platform business model and platform design is applicable to any business from any industry vertical?
Okay. Very good question. What I would do is, if you don't mind, if there is any other question coming up, I would take them both or together so that I can maybe articulate an answer that connects them. Anything else that comes up?
Yeah, hello.
Paul?
Oh, yeah. Hi. Yeah, thanks. I really enjoyed that. Lots of really good insights. My question was to do with platform cooperatives and ownership. And, you know, I suppose a lot of the platforms now can be quite exploitative from the individual level and just how you see with the work you've done, how that's evolving. So we're, you know, I suppose there's shared stakes in the platforms.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good point. Okay, let me address these two questions and then we see if the conversation brings us to other topics. So first of all, on the industries, to answer Edward's question. So yeah, I think so. I think our understanding is that it's really about, it's not really about, you know, a different way to do entirely new different things. It's really about, I would say, adopting a new approach to solving or to generating opportunities. So if you look, for example, at the two engines, learning engines and transaction engines. So, for example, reducing transaction costs in an industry is something that you can play at any level. Also, and from another point of view, creating a learning engine, so creating services that support the continuous evolution, is also something that you can apply to many, many industries, or to, I would say, any context. So we also produced a list of 7 principles a few months ago. So just to mention, one of them is, I don't know, thinking boundaryless, or another one is generating continuous learning. So all these principles have been created, you know, even to, I would say, demystify even more this idea that we want to create a platform. So it's really about embracing a new approach to design that is more more complexity friendly, is more empowering, is more about them and less about you as an organization. So I would say that these are approaches that you can adopt at any moment in anything you design. Even designing your, for example, even designing your personal development strategy may be something that you can design with a platform approach. So this is to say that, yes, I believe that this is something you can apply to every industry. Of course, when you do, for example, the value chain analysis, so when you prepare to shape an industry or an approach or a context with a design, with a platform design strategy, if you do the analysis of the value proposition, sorry, of the value chain, you will understand all the complexities that are particularly related to a specific, to a specific industry, no? But yes, I think that it's a general approach. Even if you look just into the consumer spending, there is 80% of it that needs to be reorganized. We have been testing applying industrial, platform strategies in very industrial contexts. Like, you know, we have been also thankful to work with companies that are into, I don't know, infrastructure for urban mobility, for example. So it's really, really something that is pervasive. You can approach to. You can use in any context. To answer the following question from Paul and platform cooperatives on in general cooperative and new ownership models, I think the question is, you know, basically now technology and even awareness, I would say our awareness and in the use of technology is opening new possibilities. New possibilities means distributing governance processes, distributing ownership rights, and so on. To some extent, I would say that, and this is also related to the last blog post that I'm going to share with you maybe today or tomorrow, but the question is, we are actively researching what are the possibilities of having a collective shaper, let's say. So imagine that you're doing a platform strategy. There is always someone or something that shapes the strategy. No? So we are very much used to the idea that there is a third party that addresses an ecosystem and an opportunity with a limited liability on this system. No? We have this idea of the limited liability company, for example. No? So the liability, for example, of a company like Airbnb on the urban systems that is organizing is limited. It's because this is a company, basically. What happens when you start to have systems that actively design and shape themselves? So what happens when, for example, you have a city or a community that designs a strategy? Or what happens when you have an industry association that designs a strategy? So I think to really think about cooperative models and shared ownership and shared governance, we need to change the place from where the strategy and the design comes from. And we need to move away from this individual third party entity that shapes something into, you know, we as a system, we design new strategies together. And of course, to do this, there's a huge gap to solve. And it's a gap on the history of design, and it's a gap on the history of awareness. And we are now researching, for example, the frames that integral theory gives to our practice in trying to develop a collective consciousness around problems and how to get collectives to move on and design. This is going to be very, very challenging. Let me be very frank, because at the end of the day, entrepreneurship and craft are activities that are often related to an entrepreneur. So when you don't have the entrepreneur and then when you have the collective, how does it work? This is something we need to to discover, I would say. But I would say that the platform design toolkit is a first step, is something that you can use, for example, to put all stakeholders and all players together and develop a collective understanding of the opportunity, and puts the basis to have a collective entity to address a problem or to generate a strategy. So you know, it's not going to be easy, but I think that we are getting there. We are getting there with the technology, we are getting there with design, we are getting there with awareness, and this is going to happen. It's going to be massively important in the next decades, because that's the kind of innovation we need to generate. We need to generate an innovation for which we are liable, we are responsible, not something that is a third party creating an innovation and then, you know, forget to deal with the externalities. I hope that was somehow an answer to your question.
Yeah, no, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Anything else that you guys want to add?
From my end, maybe just to say thanks for the breakdown. Unfortunately, I joined a bit late. I'm hoping I didn't miss the part that I really wanted.
It's going to be recorded, so you're going to get to the whole thing.
Yeah. Very interesting. I've been following some of your posts, and I've managed to download some of the worksheets that you have, but I'm still a bit probably on the start. I'm hoping at some point you have another webinar maybe to take us through the practical sessions, unpacking, you know, the toolkits and the processes, probably maybe step by step. I don't know whether that will be coming.
Well, maybe that's something we can definitely consider. I would say at least for the basics. While, you know, it normally takes a little bit more, but as I said, we are working on remote masterclasses, so that's going to be also an opportunity.
Okay, no, that's great. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Simon, this is Edward from India again.
Yeah.
I have two questions. First is
Edward, can I just ask you 1 second? So before taking the second question from Edward, I would like to open the space for those that didn't ask question yet, if there is anything else coming up.
Yeah, just one from me,
Marco,
after him.
Marco and Philip. Then Edward, I'm going to get back to you if we have time. So just
sure.
Marco and Philip.
Okay. Hello, Simon, and thank you very much for the presentation. It was really interesting. I downloaded at some point the toolkit from the website, and I've been testing it out, playing with it to see, you know, how to use it. And I guess my question is in relation to the masterclasses. So I work with the design thinking. I do a lot of workshops. I've had a play with the toolkit. Is there a way to perhaps create a smaller version of the 2-day masterclass that assumes that there's already quite a body of knowledge from the attendees, so that it could be compressed into either 1 day or half a day, as a much more high impact delivery.
Yes, Marco, I would suggest we keep this conversation on a side of the webinar because it's more specific interest for you. So we will write you, or you can write us, but we will write you back and follow up on this specific question if you don't mind. The short answer is yes, of course, but maybe we can discuss the details on a side.
All right, that sounds fine. Again, thank you very much. I think you guys are doing an awesome job.
Thank you. Philip.
Yeah, thanks for the presentation, Simon. It's really great stuff. My question has to do with tensions in the ecosystem and trying to get the people to buy into the context that you're trying to create for them. What's a good reference material to sort of dive deep into, you know, the argument and, you know, the debate on how to frame that that way your providers can see what you're doing from a trusted point of view rather than because I'm an entrepreneur and they're always thinking entrepreneurs are just looking for making a buck.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a good point. I think there are a couple of blog posts we could share with you. In general, I would say the question is we need to try to be more to design to look at design as a process of that involves, so a process that gets them on board. So you need to it was, for example, very interesting. Recently, we worked with a company that was doing a strategy to transform the knowledge industry in the construction industry world. And we had some people from real companies in the room, and that was amazing. You know, the level of insights that you had to involve those people in the actual design phase is really, really amazing. So first of all, I would suggest get them involved. Then sometimes you need to open a space for getting more skin in the game. So the question here is, in the future is going to be about much more skin in the game for all the participants. It's not going to be about one entity that designs and then, you know, you deal with externalities. It's much more about how do we get invested in what we do. And especially to launch something new, As you know, platform strategies takes a while to get started. No, you need a lot of investment and time and so on. Getting your early stage users to have a share of the success potential of the platform, it's really, really important. And blockchain technologies, for example, are now making this possible at scale. So there is an interesting blog post on our blog, for example, that maps the stakeholders that you have in a platform strategy in an ecosystem with what kind of tokens you can design to get them to have opportunities to cash in, for example, the success or to realize some of the success of the platform. But I would say that this is a technology. The question is the approach. How do we approach design? How do we approach our ecosystem with the will to get the ecosystem on board? On board in terms of design process, on board in terms of intentionality, on board in terms of governance, on board in terms of investment opportunities. If you do that, there's going to be a much higher level of trust between you and the ecosystem you are going to try to shape.
Well put, Simon. Thanks for that. You know,
we will also send a couple of links to this blog post that I mentioned.
Okay, terrific. Thank you.
Thank you.
There are two questions. One public that has been done to everyone by Eduardo, and another one that was made private by Greg Sherwin, but they both connect with the sort of skepticism that even these new dynamics will be eventually concentrated again and sort of capitalized by current bit scale and financial systems. And so the question is for Eduardo is, do you think it's possible the development of platform will help to develop a more fair economy, or do you think that they will be controlled by large companies anchored to traditional capitalism?
Yeah, I got to that question. There's another one. You mentioned Greg's question.
Greg was more like a point of view. Maybe you can...
I could kind of comment to that.
Yeah.
Thanks, Eugenio. No, I was just more a little chat with Eugenio about the fact that, you know, the decentralization, theoretically, of services and the development of platforms, are they going to set us up for a more fair and equitable economic world than we've seen sort of with the concentration of, because we've already seen sort of what happens when we started out with independent blogs and then, you know, the Facebooks and Twitters became their gated communities and how that created. And with the financial incentives of blitzscaling and these platforms then having these incentives to have growth at all costs and all these externalities, you know, what are your thoughts in terms of us being able to maybe get it a little bit more right this time with more platforms in the future?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think there are two layers of answering this question. One is the most, I would say, the easiest. No, so we have new technologies, we have new tools that we can use, but I think the question is we need to have a different identity. We need to have a different approach. As I said, if the design process doesn't comes from another place, so it doesn't comes from doesn't come from a collective subjectivity, I would say. So another, a different kind of subjectivity, which is not an entrepreneur, is not a startup, for example, is not, but is more like the system that designs, that's going to be very complicated. So I think if we need to invest our energy now is to how do we empower new subjectivities to design and create a new business, new organization. So that's more, I would say it's more like an awareness, design and process question than a solution that I can share with you. But of course, we can use some technologies. As you said, you know, blockchain is a new technology layer that is enabling us to do new things, but all technologies have problems, biases, and so on. So it's more a matter of our intentional identity and our intentional approach to say, okay, we want to design something that is different. Then the second layer, I'm afraid that we are entering an age of complexity where we're not going to have answers. So we're not going to have an answer in telling us this is fairer, this is more just. It's just a matter of seeing how this plays out in the system. So there's going to be much less predefined, let's say, understanding. And the understanding is going to come much more later in the process than, you know, sitting down and say, okay, we want to design something different. It's much more about, okay, how, let's see how our intentionality plays out in the system. Let's have a conversation on this. Let's try to develop this collective understanding and collective identities of our industry, our organization, the impacts we are having, and so on. And this is going to play out at scale. So, you know, we come from 20 years or so, well, more, 50 years of, okay, centralized planning, and everybody was, you know, more or less sure of what to expect from things. Now we really look into the complexity unfolding, and we don't know really how does it work, how does it seem, how does it look. So we're going to see that just more as a process of testing our ideas and seeing what happens, and you know, learning from each other. I think that's going to be the complexity we are talking about since a few decades. It's really starting to play out as such. I hope it was more or less good comment.
I like that perspective. I think the idea of the system seeing itself, certainly, and how you can kind of recognize that subjectivity, I think is a really key point. It's something I'm going to think about. That's good.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. There's another question from Anura. Regarding, you know, what are the constraints that organizations have faced while trying to embrace some of these principles? Well, I will try to be shorter because there's another question coming up. You know, there are all sort of constraints. The most pressing constraints normally for companies to embrace this new way of thinking are related to entrenched interest, I would say. So silos, or for example, something that comes up very often is, you know, I cannot do that because it's not my business unit context, you know, something like that. And this is crazy in a world of complex networks, because nothing is going to play out just in the garden of your business unit. You know, basically, whatever boundary you create in your organization at this moment in time is a political and social structure. It's going to create debt, I would say. It's going to create a disconnection from reality. So, as I said, no opportunity is going to play out just in a business unit context. Everything is going to be much more borderless and interactive and so on. So the first and the most important constraint that organizations need to, I would say, if not remove, but really play with, is this idea of having boundaries, this idea of having silos, this idea of having units, you know. if you want to address the potential of a market that is increasingly, or society that is increasingly interconnected and so overlapped and so on, if you have a structured company with everybody protected in this bubble of responsibilities that disconnects them from reality, that's going to be a huge problem. And indeed, if you look at one of the most successful companies in the world now in terms of their understanding of platforms and ecosystem, it's Haier Group, a Chinese company doing white goods. We have a description of this company on a blog post on our blog, but essentially it's a company that works in a very interesting way. They don't have units. They really have just a network of enterprises interacting with each other and competing with each other. Of course, this is going to be hugely challenging to organizations, especially, I would say, Western organizations, because injecting this kind of competition inside an organization with the aim of removing all this technical debt and organizational debt is going to be hugely challenging for all the management and leadership in existing organization. But I think that's the kind of challenge that we are going to see coming up in the next 20 years. An organization and a structure need to justify themselves. They need to exist for a reason. If they exist for no reasons, they're going to be crushed by the increasing need to be connected with reality. So that's feedback to Anugra. There's another question, and then I think we're going to take just this and maybe another one. From Stina, regarding how do we adapt the language to work with non-business actors? That's really, really a good question. We have been working with the United Nations, and indeed we have seen this language topic coming up from time to time. I think, you know, I would like to answer in a way that is not really related to this question, but it's a more general topic. The nature of this work is open source. So any, for example, any NGO player or any institutional player that wants to change the language, it can easily do that. You know, basically we are happy to provide all the sources of our canvases so people can really modify them, reinterpret them. You know, when we have been working with them, this is something that we... with the social sector, for example, or the development sector, this is something that we did. We changed a little bit sometimes the question, sorry, the words and the elements and the language and so on. There's another one from Edward still. I think this is going to be the last one, if you guys don't mind. Regarding which kind of organizations, enterprises are candidates of adopting platform models, platform business models. You know, basically, as I said before, the point here is every you know, this is not something I would say radically. Not something new. It's just looking and evolving the way of doing business and to looking at business that we had in the last century. You know, the story, for example, of and the tradition of design and the tradition of service design and lean innovation and so on. So our practice is really, really something that fits on top of a body of knowledge. That is the body of knowledge of creating innovations, but it's much more systemic. It's something that just injects system thinking into how you do business, injects system thinking into what do you prototype. So I think, again, this is something that applies to every industry, but for a very simple reason. For example, we spoke about enablers and drivers. These enablers and these drivers are so pervasive that are now applicable to every industry. So in any industry, you can create much value now from the edge, more value from the edge. In any industry, your stakeholders are looking into personalized experiences. Maybe there is a blog post that we can share with you again, and if you guys can take notes, We developed a quick navigator. It's a set of questions that you need to ask about your industry. Answers questions like, you know, are my consumers looking for more personalized experiences? Are my producers, the producers in this industry, looking to specialize in a niche? These are the kind of questions that you need to ask to understand better if the industry is ripe for that kind of model. And, you know, regarding your quick follow-up, and again, this is the last one we're going to take in terms of losing revenues, you know, is this a risk for traditional businesses to lose revenues? I want to close with a funny note. I would say funny. Well, there's a blog post from Clay Shirky that I really suggest you guys to look into. It's called The Collapse of Complex Business Models. It's really interesting because basically the question of revenues is not something that, you know, for example, losing revenues because you have adopted a platform strategy is not something that depends on you. It's not something that depends on the company. It's the system that is asking for a new model. So if the system is asking for your new model, then your company have two choices. It's either, I would say, connect with these new models and enable them and let them emerge, or just ignore them until they become so important that the only answer that your question, that your organization can put together is collapsing. So that's more or less the idea. No? So again, innovation comes from the ecosystem. It doesn't come anymore from the organization. The organization has a mission to let this innovation happen and institutionalize it. So that's, it's a power shift, let's say, from the organization to the ecosystem that we need to get to deal with. Okay, I think we are really late. So, well, late. We are on time, but we don't have much more time to answer all the questions. It's a pity because it was really, really, really interesting, but we want to keep this webinar 1 hour and a half maximum, otherwise it becomes very complicated for people to watch it. I would leave the word to Lucia and Victor, if you guys want to add a couple of final comments on, especially on, I don't know, Barcelona or something like that.
No, just to say that, well, if you want to join us in Barcelona, we can send you more information with the recorded video. We can send you also the link for the masterclass in Barcelona if you want to join us there. And we are going to apply Platform Design Toolkit.
Yeah. Sorry, from my side, if you need more information regarding the facility, regarding Sare Creapolis and how to join this event, just email us and ask for more information. And that's all. I hope to see you soon.
Yeah, briefly on my side, it would be lovely to have you in our masterclass in Barcelona. In general, every masterclass, especially the public one, that are very diverse. The conversations are always very rich. And at the end of the day, we develop this framework, this thinking, thanks to this conversation and by really enacting this knowledge and this understanding together with you. The last one was a pleasure. I'm pretty sure the next one will be also a pleasure. So you're all welcome to join.
Thanks again. Thanks very much, everybody. We really thoroughly enjoyed having you on this webinar. We're going to send everybody that was registered the links and the registration. Really, thanks again for your time, and looking forward to get in touch with you in the coming weeks. Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks all. Thank you, Simon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.